Do it. Hey, it's Drew. Welcome to Satyr Art Studio in our fifth lemonade stream. I'm going to just jump right in here. I was running late today. I'm Drew. This is my studio, and I sculpt tabletop miniatures for a living. And our computer is broken. So we're just going to have to use the phone again. The parts are coming in. New parts are arriving. Unfortunately, one of the more critical parts that I need in order to get the PC up and running again is the PSU. And that thing is still in Utah. I know, I mean, maybe I should have just gone ahead and checked out a big box store in the neighborhood, but I really hate shopping at big box stores. I much prefer to just get my parts online. So I'm left waiting for deliveries. That's just my preference, I guess. Not ideal. So we're gonna work on number 5. And I'll be streaming for the next 2 hours and while I'm working on this. And I'm just gonna jump right in here. No muss, no fuss. Actually, I gotta turn on the stream as it stands. I'm trying to reduce the load right at the moment on my tablet, because I'm using a tablet for a PC right now, and that's not ideal. Nope. Turning on the chat using the tablet to help me see the chat, and if anybody's commenting, I'll be able to respond like normal. At least I got that much working for me. All right. I'm a little late today because I had a heck of a time with petty stuff. Petty business stuff that had to be taken care of. First order was, well, I don't have a printer since my tablet is so old it doesn't want to communicate with my printer. For whatever reason, drivers be damned. And so I had to drive 20 miles just to get my postage printed at an Office Depot. That's how bad it is. Oh, man. Had to do that. Got some canned air while I was at it. Since I'm in the store, might as well. And then I spent another several minutes getting in touch with the customer service of my postage processing service, which I use a company called, ShipStation. And what ShipStation does is allows me to go ahead. I've got to change that setting. Oh. What ShipStation does is it allows me to go ahead and, just print my postage online. And I use USPS First Class. I'd like to use USPS's actual website, but I need to coordinate my postage with my store, and that's where ShipStation comes in. But what really aggravates me, and I just find it like hard to believe that it's so, is that the only way I can get USPS postage printed from the studio here is using stamps.com. Somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but as far as I can tell, stamps.com has an exclusive access to USPS for postage printing. Pretty much a monopoly. And, well, all well and good if they're providing a decent service, but it's hard to describe. What's going on? What was it? I'm losing my train of thought. It was 3 weeks ago or so, maybe a whole month. Yeah, it was quite some time. I was using stamps.com settings to generate my international postage. And there was a form that they helped me to fill out that's supposed to autofill my international postage. And I filled it out. This is what I want. And then I went ahead and I purchased postage sometime later, thinking that form was going to work. It did not apply to my international postage correctly. The settings that I placed into the fields didn't take. They used other settings instead. And I'm like, okay, I clearly did something wrong. I'm going to adjust this, check these settings, and try again. Anyway, I eventually got the postage for the international deliveries taken care of, and the with the correct customs information finally entered, but I had to do it manually. But more importantly, I had paid for 2 reams of postage before I realized the problem. I applied for the original postage that I actually printed, in fact. Lots and lots of paper gone in the trash. I applied for that original postage to be refunded to me, and they did credit my balance at stamps.com. But there is no way to recover that money from stamps.com, and it was thousands of dollars. So the good news is, all the postage that I'm going to be, like, you know, creating for all of my upcoming orders, and for the next, I don't know, I suspect the balance can last me a good 3 months. It probably won't be until the holiday season until I have to, like, start putting more money into the account now. Yeah, they're just gonna hang on to that money. It's like, sorry, no, that's ours now. Do you want to close the account? You can get the money back if you close your account. And I'm like, well, do I want to close my account? What's my options? What are my alternatives? I'm going to contact stamps.com and ask them what other service providers are there that will help me to get, you know, first class USPS postage. Nobody. Just stamps.com. That's the only one. I ended up with a customer service rep who was really annoying and trying to, like, offer me UPS and FedEx as options. I'm like, no, that's not what I'm asking you for. Are you not listening to what I'm saying? Oh, well and good in the end. It's not like somebody's robbing me or anything. It's just frustrating because, you know, these services erect themselves as small business friendly. But somewhere in the executive office, you know, they don't think that my business is big enough. To be a small business in their books. Thinking. Anybody who was looking for me pretty much an hour ago and I wasn't there, I apologize. I debated. I debated with myself about going online today because I'm so grouchy. Feeling like somebody's punk punching bag. Feel like I'm being used and taken advantage of. Kind of makes me feel grouchy. I'm not sure I should put anything on his legs. No, this is fine. Oh, right. I have the Z-axis issue. See, the thing about the blowgun figure that's tricky is, see this, all this opening here between his face and the arms? Well, I can't have that. That has to be closed up with something. Now, I either drop fill in there, or I don't know, I could try to just, challenge Andy to cast with these gaps in there and not tear the mold. He surprised me before, but to be honest, I don't feel good, like, trying to take advantage of him. I suspect that, you know, even if he does pull it off, it'll be at the expense of a lot of extra elbow grease. I could be wrong. Maybe it's like falling off a log for him. I don't know. Maybe I'll just, like, take a picture of it before trying to create a fill and ask him. I just can't think of any kind of material I'd want to put in there. Maybe I should just fill only one side, and then Andy only has to worry about the pass through here. Maybe angle it in the mold so that it is slightly turned and it pulls out this way. You're catching me in the middle of actually, like, trying to rationalize, you know, the details of how these things are cast. If you ever, like, get figures from me, and you look at it and you say, how did they do this? Well, it's kind of a combination of Andy's know-how and sometimes my expertise in this as well. Though personally, I would call it expertise. It's not for me to say. I better put something on my face. Like, you know, a visor or something to actually look at what I'm doing. Nobody's in the chat yet, and it's been a good few minutes, so I suspect that my usual crowd is not around because they figured I was gone for the day, which is reasonable. And I was AWOL. But in the final measure of things, I need to get to work. Work needs to be done. Especially since I'm several thousand dollars poorer because I can't get the money back from my stamps.com account. Just gonna have to keep at it. Okay, so we effectively have a range of three different size circles. Thank you. And a knife. Don't know where the knife's at. There's a knife. Oh, there it is. This is the sharpest one I've got right now. So, I guess I should put something on his arms. That would help. Although anything I put on his arms would be outside detail, I wouldn't put anything on the inside of his arms. Rationally, that is. But if I sculpt... I think if I sculpt some armor on the outside of his arms, that'll make it more plausible. When his arms on the inside go further in, perhaps. Oh. I'll do a lot of smoothing first. Yesterday I, like, said people should, make comments and stuff. Leave comments and recommendations in the chat. I mean, below the video. And then I forgot to, make the video public. I'm trying to get used to it, but, you know, when I publish videos using OBS on the PC, it works pretty smoothly. It just automatically goes up, goes live, and then is recorded. But when I'm using the phone, you have to manually go into your account and toggle to have it go live. To go public, that is. And I keep forgetting that every time. So I've got a new motherboard. It's behind me. I have a new processor. That's behind me. I have new RAM. That's behind me. I'm also getting a new cooler. And that should be arriving today, in fact. At least they say it's going to arrive today. I suspect maybe it won't, after all. Because at the moment, it's in Kentucky. How they're going to get it to me all in this day from down in Kentucky, I have no idea. If they do, I'll be impressed. But at the rate things are going today, I wouldn't expect miracles from me. So after that, all I'm pretty much waiting on is the power unit, which is still in Utah. And I'm told that they don't anticipate that to be delivered until Tuesday, which is very bad news for me, personally, in terms of my organization, because Tuesday I'm going to be packing to leave for Gen Con. So it's very likely, although I'll fight against it and try to do better than this, but it's likely, possible, that I won't have my live stream back to normal until after I return from Indianapolis. A bit after, because I need a couple days to, like, do a few things and get squared away before I come back online. So I don't think I'm going to be resuming normal broadcast service until close to the middle of August, around the 9th, 10th, maybe even the 11th or 12th, perhaps. It'll be very frustrating. I'll still be working. But I won't be live streaming it. Just like trying to minimize the volume of the putty that I've put on the figure. Jesse Raspberry. Your sculpture is slightly out of frame. If you could move your hand down a little so we can see the mini more, that would be swell. Or the camera, whichever is easier. Hey, Jesse, I don't think I remember you in the chat before. Welcome. Yeah, this is not my usual format, in case you were lurking before. My computer has died, and today I am using my phone. But regulars in the chat know that, frankly, I have a real hard time trying to put my sculpting efforts in front of the camera. Usually my format is mostly just alternating scenes between my face, a close-up of work I've done, and then that's pretty much it. When people want to see what I'm actually doing, I hold it up to the camera. To be frank, this pose is not working for me. I'm an all-around person. I'm always moving around. So for me to hold it steady in front of the camera, it's not my bag. These things that I'm working on, this is my product. This is my money. The stream is not monetized. It doesn't give me any money. I'm just here working as I normally would. And as I normally would, frankly, would be for me to like lean back in my office chair and sculpt my figures on my belly like some otter trying to crack abalone shells on his belly. That's how I actually work. So for me to lean over like I am right now on my figures like this is already kind of... It compromises the quality of my work, frankly. For me personally, I have a hard time like maintaining what I do. And I discovered when I first started streaming about 4 years ago, I haven't been doing it since then. I took a long break and I just started again last year. But 4 years ago when I was trying to stream, I was trying to like struggle so hard to like entertain and prioritize the stream's quality. And this time, no, I can't. I mean, I usually, up until just recently, I've been doing contract work for the past 20 years. And I was like starting to degrade the quality of the work I was doing for my clients. And I was like, I can't do this. I can't live stream and create good work, then I can't live stream because I have to keep up my quality of work. So yeah, using my Pixel camera like this is the compromise. It's not really my actual format. If you have any questions about how to sculpt stuff out of old green stuff, I'm perfectly willing and happy to like chat about it and show you techniques. As long as it doesn't, you know, like slow me down in terms of the work I'm trying to accomplish. Just before you got on here, I was like musing out loud about this Z-axis issue I've got going on here. If you can see it, I'm trying to take a look at the camera now. These spaces right here, this is supposed to be a single axis casting, but these spaces right here, they might tear at the mold, and I'm evaluating as I go. It's like, will I fill those spaces with detail, or will I just wait and talk to the mold maker and ask him, do you think that I need to fill these spaces? I mean, if Andy can cast it, if Andy can make it work, then I'm just gonna go ahead and let it go. I'd love to leave the spaces in there, but I don't have any expectation that that's gonna work out. My experience as a caster from years ago tells me that these spaces will eventually tear the mold. But it just looks so awful filling it up, you know? When it comes to Oldhammer, so many of the miniatures back in the day were like specifically designed in the earliest Oldhammer, back in the 80s, were specifically designed to be like not just single axis castings, but clean, simple single axis castings. You would have figures that, you know, their poses were a little bit twisted and compromised just to make sure that, you know, there were no serious undercuts. Because The cost of replacing a mold, because your undercuts eventually teared at the cavities of the mold, that adds up. And I'm pretty sure that, you know, Brian, Ansel, and the guys were really, really trying to save money wherever they could in regards to the mold-making process. Save on rubber and everything. Hey, Odo. This is interesting. I show up late, and I start streaming late, and new faces show up. This is pretty cool. How's it going? Yeah, I've been having a hell of a morning. Usually I start around 10:30 my time. -5 GMT in the morning. But this time, you know, I had errands to do and stuff. Having your computer, your only computer in your studio, die on you. When you work, you know, all alone, it kind of sucks. Oh, wait a minute. No, I want a headband. It's funny, though. Here I am, like, sculpting green stuff online, blah, blah, blah. Ask me anything. I'll show you how it's done. And it's like, this is actually, you know, the old way of sculpting miniatures. Fewer and fewer people ever do it this way now. Most miniature sculpting these days is done either on computer and or using polymer clays. Kind that you bake off eventually, like Fimo, bees putty and stuff. Good products, all. This is just the old-fashioned way of doing it. They had polymer clays back in the 70s and the 80s, but they weren't very good. The formulas were still kind of rough, so you couldn't get the kind of detail and stuff that you needed. Also, the mold-making processes had some evolution to make. Because back in the 70s, the traditional way of making a mold of a miniature so that you could cast it was vulcanization, where you'd apply pressure and lots of heat to melt the mold around the figure. And the reason that green stuff became popular in the industry back then was because this stuff is actually pretty tolerant to those levels of heat and temperature. It turns a little bit darker green or even brown, but it's still intact. Whereas if you took something else like a polymer clay and tried to vulcanize it, it would just crush it into a powder. It would just wreck it. I am working on my portfolio for my university application soon. What major? University? What university? Okay, so I'm gonna try to, like, spread the volume of the arm sculpting to the inside and see if I could close up the gap in there just a little bit with the detail. Like Avatar Plus. We grabbed your first two limited edition demons. Any chance for more on the way? Yeah, but you know, almost upon request, I decided to just, you know, hold off a little bit. There were several people who kindly, like, PM'd me and said, dude, you're wrecking my wallet. And I can understand that. It's like one thing for me to release stuff that's going to be in my store just whenever I feel like it. But releasing limited edition things and challenging people to, like, you know, hurry up and buy it before they're all gone, you know, when people only have so much they can budget to their fun in a given amount of time, it's a little bit of a dick move. So, you know, it's easy for me to just say, okay, I'll just take a break. So the next one, I'm not saying names, I'm just going to say there's going to be a, or I plan on making a godforsaken giant turkey vulture demon creature sometime around the end of August, the beginning of September, I think. I doubt that I'll have it ready to go up for sale until after the first week of September. I'm guessing at the rate things are going. But yes, the answer is yes. Art and design? Odu. Well, to each their own, Odu. But if you ever asked me for my advice about art school, I'd say don't do it. Then again, art and design, a real design class, I don't know, a real design degree, or master's or undergrad. I mean, if you're talking about a master's, then you already know what the deal is with art school. I'm very down on art school. Oops. Practically lived the art school life for a good third of my adult life. It's one of those situations, it's like, I wish I knew then what I know now. Joe K has arrived. How's it going, Joe? You still at work, or are you signing off yet? It's pretty late for you now, isn't it? I'd like to hurry up and get on with, oh, hang on a second. I gotta put some glue under there. I'd like to hurry up and get on with the detailing of this figure, but I simply have to make sure that these volumes are right. Ugh, what a mess. I'm home, it's afternoon here. Oh, good. Making dinner for yourself or something? So often, when Joe signs in, he's doing it from work and he's busy with, you know, has his hands full with his own sculpting. I'm rushing to do three more War of the Roses minis, because next week I'm leaving for my sea... I can't... Oh, your seaside house. Oh, nice. How far away is it from you? From where you're usually to be found. So, Odu, my position on art school is simply that art school is... A degree in art is generally kind of, like, worthless. The only time that going to art school really, really makes a big difference is in the contacts you can make, because it's kind of a great place to convene with other professionals. But when it comes to actually picking up skills, I don't know. I think you're... Well, it depends. A tight design-oriented art school. If the art school is truly a design-oriented art school, then maybe it can help out. Because that's more of a professional application. I made the mistake of going to a rather fine arts-oriented art school. Even though it had a design department, the fact that it was predominantly a fine arts school kind of made the design department a little wishy-washy and ineffective. That school's primary mission, in hindsight, turned out to be cultivating artists who were going to be prepared to do that little song and dance at the galleries on Fifth Avenue in New York, and try to generate, you know, tax write-off stuff for the wealthy. Jackson Pollock 4.0. And actual skills were not being taught by most of the teachers. It was just wasting time, mostly there to just collect money from wealthy parents who had nothing better to do with their kids. Just send them to art school. I should note that mine was an applied art school, graphic design, illustration, product design, interior design. There you go. Well, that's my point. It's like, it has to be a school that offers like a structured, you know, course load, and not some wishy-washy bullcrap like in interpreting the color of blue with chicken wire, as I say. That's what I ended up with in undergrad. When I went and did my graduate degree, I was like, one, I already was pretty despondent about art school in general, but mostly, I was just looking for a master's degree that would help teach me the things I should have learned, that I should have learned in my undergrad. Also, I was working really hard to try to cultivate relationships with my instructors. I got a good start, but my mistake the second time around for a master's degree was I went into it thinking that I was going to work in the film and game industry in California. But by the time I was like two-thirds the way through my degree plan at that school, I realized that most of the people who worked those jobs in the film and the games industry, they were screwed over all the damn time. You know, they didn't get to unionize, they didn't get any protections. It was ridiculous. My partner agrees and I semi-agree. We both went to Ringling College of Art and Design, but definitely felt underprepared after graduation. Yeah. My point is that, okay, by and large, higher education platform, its structure is actually a pantomime disguising the fact that it's an old boys club. Or at least that's what it used to be. And it still is, for the most part. It's just got a different mask on. And you can still, like, develop a career and learn your craft in business, in medical, lots of really technically oriented things. You can channel it through, you know, a degree format, the whole structure of a university and everything. But art really has no place in a university structure. The instructions that you need to practice and hone for art, the university format really is not the optimal format. It's just, as far as I'm concerned, it's mostly just a lie that's being sold to a lot of gullible people, including myself. When it comes to learning art, if you really need to learn it from somebody else, not just books or simply practice, which will usually be enough to get you any job in an art field that you want. Just show them a portfolio. If your portfolio is strong, you get the damn job. They don't care what university you went to. They don't care at all. What school you went to has absolutely no bearing, because in the art field, there's no old boys club. How's the work going today, Yoda? Yeah. Hey, Dave. It's a rough start today, because I had to... Oh, boy. First thing I did this morning... My brain's all over the place because I'm very flustered by things. First thing I had to do this morning was actually put on my bicycle helmet and ride my bike out to the garage that I had my car being repaired at. Because I needed the car to be up to snuff for the drive to Indianapolis and back. I thought it sounded kind of rough and I wanted to make sure that everything was in order. And I had to leave it over there overnight. So I ride my bicycle at the crack of dawn, no breakfast, out to the garage to pick up my car. The garage wasn't even open yet. They just left the car out back with the keys under the seat. And I threw the bike into the car and off I went to my other errand, which was to drive for 20 miles. Well, 11 there and 11 back, so that's 22 miles. Just to print out my postage, my latest ream of postage. Because I cannot, for the life of me, get my tablet here to actually connect to my printer. Sigh. Deep sigh. It's a heck of a drive just to print out some postage. I know some of you guys in the city would, like, not believe me, but I really couldn't find anyone nearby to just print a small bunch of postage like that for me. I had to go all the way out there. Ah, ridiculous. There used to be a Office Depot just down the road from me, but they closed up the year after we moved in. And then I came home to take care of my next errand, which was to call up stamps.com and ShipStation, my postage bundler service online, the thing that I use to create the postage that I have to print. And find out why they're not refunding me the thousands of dollars that I had accidentally spent on a botched postage from last month. I had a whole bunch of international labels that were printed incorrectly, so I had to have them refunded and print new ones. And that much worked out okay, but then there's this... They're giving me the money in a balance to my account, so I don't lose it outright, but I don't have the cash on hand either. So I'm going to Gen Con. That much is certain. But when I get to Gen Con, I'm not going to be spending any money. If art school did anything for me, it gave me my partner, so I'm... Jesse, yeah, I know exactly what you mean. That's where I met my wife. For better or worse. And I personally believe it's for the better. I've never met anybody else quite like her, and I enjoy her presence in my life. But and I would not have met her if I hadn't gone to that art school. But damn. That's a lot of money just to find a partner for life. I'm just, you know, there's always the exception. There's plenty of people. Well, now I don't know about plenty of people, but there are people who go to art school, learn their craft, hone it, you know, engage with their instructors, befriend some of them, lifelong friendships and contacts, letters of reference, job opportunities. It all happens for some people. But for the most part, I think that the art school scene is a bit of a scam. It's just taking advantage of a lot of people in a field that's rather... That's the thing about it, really. the more technical stuff, like, you know, creating commercials and illustration and you know, the more technical things, there's skills that you can learn, like, you know, the ropes, and then specialize, perfect. But a lot of things about art school that they're trying to quote-unquote teach you are very subjective. The art is subjective at its best. And I'm sorry, you shouldn't be paying the same amount of money for something that's subjective that other people are paying for a medical degree. That's outrageous and obscene. And it's a scam. I think people who operate art schools, and almost all of them, if not all, are like privately owned, you know, institutions, just there to like make money for somebody else. And they are, I think they're scams. Taking advantage of the university laws that are built there, put there for managing universities, and approving of them, accreditation, the whole shebang, which is designed chiefly for people at the best to be lawyers and doctors and, you know, people of business who have to know what they're doing, or other people's lives could be wrecked. You know, really important stuff. And then they say, for the same amount of money, you could learn how to paint landscapes. And it's just an obscene lie, in my opinion. Art should teach you the craft. That was my approach. When I first enrolled in my undergrad, I thought I was going to be taught like basic fundamental skills that I didn't already have. And in every classroom that I entered, I was being shown things that I already knew, but I had to like go through the hoops to demonstrate that I already knew them. I learned very little through any of those classes. And somehow the classes that I did think that I needed to like go through a whole bunch of really obscene and absurd courses in order to qualify to be in them. I don't know. In short, Dave, I'm having a kind of a crappy day, and I'm being very, very whiny and complainy. And I'm going around in circles on this figure way too long. I gotta focus. Gotta focus. This right here is not like a fin from his head. This is going to be a shape of some feathers. But I have to let it dry in order to create the feathers. Let me see here. I want some of them to be pointing up too. Well, to be fair here, the School of Fine Arts is free if you pass the exams. That's nice. That is very nice. So it's a rough day for me. But I'm going to get the basics of this figure down too, just like the others. This is the thing, I am going to be streaming over the weekend as well. That's the thing about the lemonade streams for the week. The idea is that I get the bulk of the work on a Frogman done each morning until, I forget, Monday? I said it somewhere, and I meant it. Normally, I don't stream on the weekends. I think the way I see it is that the quality of my stream has declined because of technical difficulties, so I might as well increase the quantity. So as you can see, I'm sculpting something of a skirt on this one. Quantity has a quality of its own. Usually, when I take my time, and with larger figures, if I'm sculpting a skirt like this, I'll first sculpt and cure a shape under to hold the skirt's details up so I can work on them with support behind it. But in this case, I'm going to just try to generate the skirt right out in the open without any support structure underneath. A lot of these details I'm doing, I'm just pulling right out of the air. I'm not really planning anything very carefully here. I'm being very organic, which cuts both ways, as I've explained before. It's like I'm trying to close one eye and grasp a sense of spontaneity in the sculpting. That I'm just trying to replicate the feel of an Oldhammer figure. And so me going around and around and around the figure like I'm doing right now is me trying to process the what the hell am I doing here? What's this gonna be? And I'm just like feeling it out as I go. Not really sure where I'm going. That's why it's taking me so long. You know, if I had, like, you know, a drawing in front of me of a design and a plan, whatever stage I was working on would probably already be done and in the cooker, and I'd be moving on to the next figure that has drawings. But in this case, that's partially why I'm doing one figure a day for 8 days, I don't really have those kinds of plans. I don't have any drawings. I'm just kind of like charging forward on a wing and a prayer. Some people don't realize this, but Oldhammer, Citadel Miniatures, when they did their miniatures, very rarely did they actually have drawings on hand in the old days. You know, a sculptor would just have a vague assignment of what, you know, could be useful, what they would like to see. Sometimes just a name, and then the sculptor would just generate something, and then they'd fill in the blanks. When you see artwork showing the figures, I'm going to use a curved needle here. If you see artwork in the books and stuff showing the characters doing things, that artwork was more often than not in the early days created after the miniatures were made. They would just like cast up the miniatures when they could and send the initial copies over to the artist and say, here, do some artwork that features these guys. And sometimes they didn't even have the miniatures on hand yet. Nobody sculpted them. They knew they needed them. So they would just tell the artist, here, draw something. That's why, What's his name? I've got it here. Who knows their Oldhammer artwork? It's so nice to watch you hand sculpt. I feel like more people are yearning for more traditional media again in a world that's just oversaturated with digital. I see more and more people online going back to hand painting, which gives hope, since we mostly work traditional ourselves. Yeah, I was worried for a little while that 3D printing and stuff would, like, overtake the industry, but it turns out that it just drives up the demand for miniatures in general and hand sculpting as well. Here, let me show you this. Does anybody remind me the name of this artist? I've been talking with him. I can't remember right at the moment. But this artist and how he approached what we would know as space orcs. But these are not space orc designs by, you know, that's clearly right there. That's clearly a space marine, and that's IP. That miniature was ready, but he didn't have anything for space orcs. And my point is that each of these illustrations that you recognize as Oldhammer, because they were published in Oldhammer material, but the designs have nothing to do with the designs of actual, that's a space orc. But a lot of this stuff is very much, I can't remember his name. Does anybody remember his name? If I wanted to take the time to look on my, no, he's not Paul Bonner. If I wanted to take a look on my chat, I mean, not my chat, my emails, I could dig him up and find his name, because I'm checking in with him. And he's looking forward to me sculpting after those figures. But he was telling me the story about it. It was like, he was given the assignment without any models, so he just made stuff up. And they needed the art for the publication, so they just used the art, whether it looked like their figures or not. Eventually, they got the figures to him, and he started, you know, doing the illustrations per the designs that the company wanted. But in the meantime, we have these authentic illustrations from the period without any figures to go with them, and I intend to fix that. I don't know why I'm drawing a blank on his name right now. between my sculpting and this this Irish fantasy music going on here. I just can't concentrate enough to remember the name. Most of the GW illustrators got credit somewhere in the publication. I remember in the the Realms of Chaos books in particular, each illustrator got their name printed right next to the illustration on the page if you take a hard look. Most of the time. I don't know for a fact, I could ask him, but I think Tony Ackland had a lot to do with that. If not Tony Ackland, maybe it was, maybe John Blanche. I forget which one handled contract artists and when. Oh yeah, as a corporation, Games Workshop deliberately made a policy of removing all name credit somewhere around 1992. It suddenly stopped cold. I'm sculpting very poorly today, I'm afraid. Jeez, my lamp has died. Excuse me. That I can remember his name when I'm not online, but when I'm streaming, it just drops right out of my brain. No. I'm not doing this part. It's moving around too much. I need to hold on to the figure to keep it steady, to get the details right. I can't hold on to the figure if I'm sculpting it. Do the same thing for his legs, but not this stage. Oh, especially the sculptors. You never get to know the sculptors' names, ever. There was a time back in the late 90s where you could still ask around and find out who was new on the team, because they were always hiring and firing, but even that stopped. Some wrinkles in this cloth. Oh boy. Oops. Attention to the man behind the curtain. I am not going to stick with what I've done underneath the arms. I am going to carve this away and eventually replace it with something better. It's just no good to me. But up above the arms, it's all right. I can work with this. Make sure his eyes are clear. Make sure the grip of his hands on the blowpipe are viable. They look like a grip. Bring the hands close together on the blowpipe so this one less Z-axis concern. Along with that little statement I made. It's awful. Let's try Oh my god. I have to have some flow in this fabric. I guess if I can't get it from the inside of his butt, I'll get it from the out. These knots land are looking pretty awesome. Thank you. I mean, as miniatures, I intend for them to look rather flawed. Because, I mean, I'm not saying anything bad about the, the gods of the yesteryear in Citadel and everything. But frankly, some of the stuff that they did back in the 80s was kind of gack. But it had a certain charm to it. I compare myself sometimes to what Tim Prow is generating with Die Hard Miniatures. He's doing some old Hammer stuff too, but what Tim is doing is he is using all of his craft to create really great miniatures. I mean, just astounding detail. He's doing the kinds of things that you only wish that Citadel Miniatures was doing in terms of quality work back in the 80s. Whereas me, what I'm trying to do is old Hammer in the sense of, frankly, authentic simulation. So sometimes I'm like pulling my punches and I'm deliberately sculpting something kind of rough because, well, so would they. Kev Adams might show up one morning still hungover from the night before and a bender down at the pub and stuff, and or see, like, Trish would be under immense pressure from the guys for a deedline. Like, Alan Merritt would say that we simply have to have this Beast Man ready by the end of the day. We'll take it as it is. Give it to me. Thank you. That sort of thing. That sort of nonsense. As talented and as crafty as they are, they were, pushing their craftsmanship through the pinhole of a really frantic situation, it seems. Seems like it was a lot of chaos, which is the fascinating part for me. It's like lightning in a bottle. And that's the kind of thing I'm trying to simulate in the work that I do. So, I thank you for the compliment, but when I hear you say that, I read it as, you know, that they're actually looking the part. You know, I mean, I'm good enough of a sculptor to know that I'm not doing a very good job sculpting. I'm putting a lot more of my attention into just trying to be authentic, that's all. That's all I'm saying. Maybe I should, like, stick with stylus for a bit here. Texture the arms. Work the detail of the skirt. Eventually, I intend to stop doing the old hammer project and do other things instead. But I have no idea when that end time is going to come. It might be forced upon me. In the tax season for 2024, I'm going to be evaluating, you know, how well did I do without taking any commissions throughout all of 2023. Did I make a profit? It didn't only feel like that, but when I look, do the balance of the math, I find out, no, I actually cost myself some money. Well, if that's the case, then I might just have to stop. Or at least change the approach so that it's less taxing. Literally. Enjoy using styluses, though. To a fault, it has a nice organic quality to what you do. I wouldn't use a range of stylus tips on things like robots and stuff necessarily, but in organics, it really comes into its own. One little thing I'm looking forward to with these Frogmen figures is when I go to make the tabs, it's the first time I'm going to use the exact same technique that the studio used to put names on tabs, where they had this, these brass etched letters, these little itsy bitsy teeny weeny brass etched letters, and they just like spelled out the name of the figure or something on the tab using these brass etched letters, and that looks really clean and sharp. And I'm like, I never knew exactly where they came from until I asked Trish to give me some information. She didn't really remember a lot, but what few clues she was able to give me, I used to find them. And they're from Belgium, and they're still being sold. And I got some, and I'm going to use them on the tabs for these figures. it's a little thing for me. But frankly, sculpting the words on tabs really drives me nuts. It's so time-consuming to make legible letters. I'm not sure how much faster it's going to look when I use the brass etched ones I've acquired, but I am looking forward to the results at least. Because again, it'll have that authentic feel about it, which is part of my goal. Ever feel these new miniatures are over-designed due to the convenience of digital? Yeah, did you, Oh, hey, Fuller. Arkham! I didn't realize it was you who was commenting. It's good to see you. Yeah, Fuller, have you seen the, that new interview from last week? Of, Trish? By the, what do you call those guys? The painting phase? It's on YouTube. They touch on that a little bit in during the interview with Trish. I think Trish was very, you know, very fair. You know, she critiqued it, but she didn't take a big whopping dump on it. She just mentioned how, you know, it feels a little artificial and flat and not engaging, because you can kind of see where, you know, certain forms were, like, you know, mirrored and copy-pasted. They were also commenting on how When you're sculpting in digital and you're always zooming in and stuff, it's easy to miss the forest for the trees, and you end up with a product that is hyper detailed because you didn't back up enough and see that you needed space, you needed blank areas on the figure to make it work. You just filled it with detail all over the place. What did Trish call it? Spaghetti Highway? Something like that. It was a really great interview. I was commenting yesterday at how watching it has possibly changed my plans for 2024. Because I believe I even mentioned it to Trish at one point, that I had plans to revisit the, to visit the, what do you call them? The Beastmen. And I mentioned this to her, and she didn't say anything about it, but during that interview, she announced that she was actually slowly developing a range of Beastmen. And it's like, the old Beastmen were her baby, and now she's going to revisit it. And I'm like, I have no intention of sculpting, you know, Beastmen, Oldhammer Beastmen, if Trish herself intends to go back and try it again herself. That's just, you know, that's a line I will not cross. It's just like the line that I won't cross with Kev Adams style goblins. I intend to do some goblins later this year, in fact, but they're not, and I'm gonna base the designs on some Kev Adams work actually, but the Kev Adams work that I'm going to be looking at when I'm thinking about the designs for the goblins I'm going to do, they'll be Oldhammer, but old Oldhammer. That is to say, I can tell from looking at the initial, the very first Slotta and the pre-Slotta goblins that Kev did, that he was still just feeling out what his goblins were supposed to look like. He hadn't really nailed down a particular style. And it's very fascinating to look at it and see that there. So what I intend to do is, like, grab some of the goblins that he did that are not really in his signature style. He did them, they're quality work, but they're not in that style. And, you know, emulate that approach and multiply it across a range of figures. So to me, in my imagination, as I'm creating them, it's going to be more like a what if. What if Kev decided to go this way instead? What would that look like? If he just kept developing goblins in this style? You know what I mean? It's the alternative reality old hammer. Nowhere for the eye to rest. Exactly, Fuller. I like this. We've got a chat full of, savvy artist types. This is very nice. It's a shame that I'm having such a crappy day and I have such a crappy attitude because you guys are the best. And for me, personally. In terms of company to keep. You're my tribe. You're my crowd. The creatives. I mean, my wife's an artist, but she also has absolutely no interest in miniatures, or the game industry in general. For a while, I was inviting her to come be an illustrator in the game industry. It's like, I've been at this for 20 years. I know people. I can introduce you to some publishers and get you work right away. And I meant it, too. And she was like, I've met those people at the conventions you've taken me to. The answer is no. I was like, oh, okay. You're right, as usual. And she is right. It would have been a bad idea. Even when she needed the work, she was better off not picking up from, not trying to share in on my clients. And I seriously cannot afford to pay her to do any work for me. You know, if I should get a contract that needs illustration badly and doesn't have it, I can't subcontract her to help me out. At first, I thought that would be a good idea, because it'd double the household's money, but nah, we're not doing that either. Does she like fantasy? Yeah, I mean, she's a gamer. But she has her own thing. She likes to do roleplay writing when she has spare time. She does a lot of character design and character development. And her fancy is flawed characters. So she likes to create spontaneous writing, and she'll share writing with other people that she meets online, and they just take turns writing like a little bit like a what do you call it? How do you call it? An exquisite corpse. She'll sometimes engage in things that are fundamentally like an exquisite corpse of fiction writing. Where one person, writes a chapter or two and then the next person takes over. That's something she likes to do. She played my D&D game. I had a campaign that lasted for about, I think, 5 years. Since she and I got together. I've had others, but the one that I ran since we got together, I ran for about 5 years. It featured a lot of friends of hers from work, so that was one other reason to join in the game. And she was frustrating for me to DM, not least because, she's my boss and, she's my lover, but also stylistically, from the storytelling perspective, I think there's a conceit for role-playing games where, these are the heroes, and they have a story to tell. Let's tell the hero's story, and, it's a typical thing. And that is not her job. She really enjoys role-playing where people are just not nasty, necessarily, in a way where, you're taking advantage of the game and the story. But she enjoys flawed characters. She enjoys stories about characters that are flawed, that just have problems, period. Not problems to overcome, and then woohoo, they win. Just people with problems, flat out. And so, I'll create a challenge for the characters. And her character's like, nope, I'm not gonna do that because that's dangerous. I'm gonna go over here. You know, instead of being a hero, she's being a sensible schlub or something. Because she's genuinely role-playing. It was really driving me nuts. Still would have loved to have her in the campaign, but one day I said to her, you know, you're always, like, trying to avoid combat and everything, and it's really driving me nuts. Don't you think you should, like, step forward and like, you know, engage, take on the monsters, and defend somebody, be a hero? And she was like, okay. And the one time she took her character and tried to actually help other characters in the game, it was against some spiders in a tunnel, giant spiders. She got bit on the neck. Her character got bit on the neck. That's okay. We have a surgeon here who has, like, the skills necessary to save them from death, just as long as they don't roll a 19 or a 20. Rolls a 19, character dies. In my campaign, there's death is death, and everybody, you know, just has to roll a new character. And she was like, okay, well, I did what you said, and I died. I was like, well, you'll have to roll a new character. And she was like, nah, that's okay. I'll just sit over here. And that's the last time we got to play together. The short answer is yes. She likes fantasy a lot. We share a lot of anime watching together. Her bag mostly, but I sure do love it too. She likes to talk about story arcs and the writing process of movie and TV productions. She's a big Avatar Last Airbender fan right out of the box. We weren't as happy about Korra. Found it to be a rather whitewashed, weird thing. But generally, her flavor of fantasy isn't the same as what a lot of people at a convention like Gen Con next week for me are all about. She's been to Gen Con once with me. I took her in 2012. And only afterwards did she complain. It's like, you just, like, took off and we hardly ever saw each other. It's like, oh, yeah, I was busy. Because I had never shared a convention with anybody else, much less, you know, a fiancé. But generally, she just doesn't like game conventions. The crowd's a little too weird for her. It's my fault. Yeah, probably is. You're probably right, Joe. I should be ashamed. But, you know, I ended up marrying her, so I'm paying the price now. Not in the marriage. I meant that didn't come out right. I mean, like, I'm married to her, and all of my adult life now, whenever I want a game, I can't really have my wife on board most of the time. Although, there was this article that we read together, it's been a little while, it was like, I think 2 months ago. I read this article online, maybe you guys saw it. Somebody, I forget who, they wrote an article and published it, and it was about their experience as a role-playing gamer. Where they had, there's like an older roleplay gamer that has like kids and they're also doing roleplaying games, one of those situations. And they were enjoying a vacation, a holiday, as we say here in America. And they were, in a cabin or something. And they wanted to play D&D. They had nothing better to do. They're kicking back. They're a family together. They wanted to play D&D, but they didn't want... Nobody wanted to be the DM. And they were like, one of the kids who's a little bit savvy with the computer and everything was like, well, why don't we just like get the AI? I forget which AI it was. Why don't we get the online AI to DM for us? We'll give them a prompt and see what happens. And so this AI, they prompt this AI to be the dungeon master for a D&D game and everybody else's players. And it worked. A whole D&D game just, you know, arose spontaneously, and the AI was the mediator for the whole thing. You know, I started reading the article to my wife, and first she rolled her eyes and she was like, "Oh, this is a story about how the AI said, you know, puts out some really weird garbage, huh? It's really outrageous and ill-fitting." And then I read it to her and she was like, "Holy shit, that game actually worked." And then she and I looked at each other and was like, "That's how we're going to play together the next time. You and I will both be players and the AI will be our DM." And I was like, "I can see that. That sounds fun." Smart house locking doors, etc. I mean, if you think about it, the AIs that I understand that exist out there on the internet that you can use if you give them the right prompts, they get their information from like a thorough scan of what was on the internet up to about 2019 or something, I'm told. Something like that. So anything that was present online up until about 2019, the AI will like grab and make use of. So if you give the AI a prompt to play, to run a Dungeons & Dragons game, it has access to everything that's about Dungeons & Dragons that can be found online up until 2019. And that's pretty much everything. So the AI can just like, you know, throw together all of this information about, you know, all kinds of adventures, all kinds of fantasy worlds, all kinds of characters, races, monsters, stats, everything. Put it into a big pot, mix it up, and come up with something new. And, you know, the amount of material for D&D online is just so varied and so out there that, you know, the changes that you can come up with from the AI's perspective are just endless. That's why, even though it was kind of at once a generic, even though it was kind of a generic adventure, it was also thoroughly unique. It wasn't like the AI was dragging him through Saltmarsh adventure, just as written. The AI was just creating an entire thing. You have to read it. It's just really interesting. It's like right off the bat, the AI is like, "Okay, we'll do this, this, and this, so you can give me your information on your characters. You know, roll these dice, tell me what they are, introduce them." And then all the characters were made, all the information was put into the computer, and then the computer said, "Greetings and welcome to your adventure. You're in the land of blah blah blah, and you're going to..." It's like, I'm doing a bad job of describing it. You just have to find the article and read it for yourself. But it's exciting. For many reasons. There's no real substitute for a living DM. But let it be known that the AI's technology as it stands right now is already ready for the job. That could be a nice horror movie. Please tell us how that worked out. What, do you mean the article that I read? Apparently the family played for what was, I would guess, must have been 3 hours of game time, and then they just stopped. They got like, you know how it is where an adventure is supposed to take you to the dungeon, but you really don't get as far, you don't only get as far as the front gate because you had an encounter on the way? That's kind of where they were at. They started out in the town getting their supplies. One of the players decided to, you know, be really crazy and get a very unique mount from the stables. Tried to steal the mount, it didn't work out. They almost got caught. You know, hijinks. And that alone really tells you something, because that's the kind of nonsense you get from a game that's just run by a human. Oh, how we work out when we play? We'll find out. We haven't taken any initiative. Haven't done a thing about it yet. My wife's having some health troubles recently, and I've been up to my eyeballs in work because she can't work right now. So that's been kind of the centerpiece of our personal life right now. That and I built her a greenhouse, and she's enjoying plants. So she's got enough on her hands with her hobby right now, as it stands. So we just haven't picked it up yet. But it's out there. It's a thing that we're both interested in doing. So I consider myself lucky that, you know, my wife is a fantasy person, and she is a gamer, and she's a geek, and I met her at art school, so what do you expect? And maybe my art school experience was worth every penny, just for that alone. I'll let you know when I'm about to die. Was it worth it? All those student loans? Just to find the woman of my dreams? If I decide it wasn't, you can be damn sure I'm not going to tell her about that. Or anybody else for that matter, I guess. Maybe that's why I'm waiting until I'm almost dead. It's not the greatest, but it's something. Like I said, I'm going to work on the blowpipe end separately. And that big fin on the back of his head, that's just the substructure for some feathers. I let this substructure, like, dry completely hard, and then I sculpt the feathers on it. It doesn't look like much, I guess. But he's in line with the rest of them. They're coming along nicely. I'm liking this. I'm liking the feel, the texture of the line as it comes together. I think they're looking pretty good in a general way. I can't wait. There's like three or four shields in the set, and they're all blank and round right now. I can't wait to put designs on those shields. That's gonna be fun. Oh, thanks, Jesse. How much does art school cost in the U.S., out of curiosity? Oh, about as much as a really decent business degree, which is actually worth the money. Back in the 1990s, the art school that I went to for my undergrad cost about $40,000, more or less. Maybe a little bit. Yeah, about $40,000, I think. These days, you know, decades later, most art schools cost anywhere between 60 grand to about 90 or 100 grand. I think some art schools charge even more than 100 grand, but they're in a class unto themselves. I think they're there for a completely different class of art school student. Oh yeah, yeah, you can go into serious debt over art school and still not have a job. Yeah, Jesse knows. So take it with a grain of salt when I get all, like, grousy about art school and how useless it is. It's measured on the scale that I'm thinking about all the poor schlubs like me who went into, like, serious debt over going to art school and have really nothing more to show for it than what you already could have done. This work that I'm doing right now, I could have done before art school. All I had to do was find the right mentor, just a single individual, to show me a little bit of what they do, and I'm off to the races. And I would have had a whole career without having any debt. Why? Joe, what do you think America is built on? The United States of America was built on, let's think about it, stealing land from indigenous peoples, followed by a lot of people who didn't have any room to move around in Europe, coming over to this continent to try to help steal land, and also, let's think, indentured servitude, getting a bunch of indentured servants to do the work for them so they didn't have to, and make a lot of money, and then when indentured servitude wasn't good enough, then they got slaves who cost even less. And, and then with the slaves, they were able to create an economy that could compete and underbid all the other markets in the globe. And then when the slave-driven economy in the colonies was starting to really cost, like, you know, real industries over in Britain, serious cost, like the tea trade and everything, they went ahead and decided to tax all the tea the point is that the foundation of the nation that I live in is slavery. It is impoverishment. It's to drive people down in terms of economic wealth just for the sake of maintaining power. That's how the government is built. That's the foundation of the document. The first lines of our documents are really, really nice, pretty things, like all people are created equal. But the people who were writing that specifically meant that to be landowning white men. Period. Full stop. That was their goal. To protect their interests as landed white men. And the nature of the nation, in spite of all the pretty dressing in the window, has largely unchanged this entire time. It's only been a couple hundred years. It's not a deep history like Greece has. The United States of America is just, it's a place where a lot of people hurried up and tried to make as much money as possible in any way they possibly could. Oh, I went to the best and most expensive private art school here, including a BA, and from 2000 it was about 3,000 euros a year. That's pretty nice. Corporate power, unfortunately, yeah. Yeah, you know, you use the term corporation when talking about how like, things like the, how companies operated back in the 1700s. And it puts a whole lot of the politics of the 1700s into a new perspective. Anyway, I could go on for forever. Today it's 38. It hasn't changed much. Wow. I should go because I'm a grousy fool. So that was the bulk of the design stylation, I created a new word, for Frogman number 5, and we have 3 more to go. Which one is number 6? It's this one, who gets a shield attached. So I'm gonna get the shield onto him before the next stream, and we'll take it from there. I'll probably put a hat on his head, a long loincloth maybe. Yeah. One more soldier. After that, it's going to be this person, and I'm not sure what the hell he's about. I think he's a banner bearer now. For a while I thought he was going to be like some sort of witch doctor, but I think he's going to be a banner bearer. And this one's going to remain a leader, and I'll do the leader last. That's the plan, at least. I'm gonna stick to it. Thank you so much for joining me, guys. I really appreciate your time and your patience with the blurry, you know, camera picture. Ugh. If you're new here or you haven't seen me before and you wonder what my normal format is, easily enough, just go to the channel here on YouTube and look at my stuff from just last week and any time before then, and you see what the normal format looks like and compare. But this is what we're stuck with until I get the rest of the parts to my PC put together again. And wish me luck. I have fun assembling PCs. I'm not all that great at it. I have experience over the past decades doing it every once in a while. We'll see. But I hope to be back online with my regular format probably just before I go to Gen Con around Tuesday or Wednesday. And if I screw up with it, then, you know, when I get back from Gen Con the following Tuesday or Wednesday. All right, then. I will sign off now and wish you a great evening. And, yeah, hopefully I'll see you guys tomorrow. I'll be doing this stuff on Saturday and Sunday. Take care now. See ya.